Hey there everybody, it's Nathan Cool, and in this episode, I want to talk about camera and lens recommendations for real estate photography for 2022. Now, this is going to concentrate on still photography. It's not going to be going into the video aspect, that's a different topic, or virtual tour. So this is for the majority of the work you probably do, which is for interior real estate photography. And this is an important issue, so I want to cover this in a couple different steps here. First, I want to talk about it in general so we understand some of the recommendations that I'm going to go through. So we have some generalizations that no matter what brand or what model of camera or lens you may choose, why I would make the recommendations I am in this video, and also what you should be looking for. As we know, gear is one of the biggest investments that we make in photography to begin with. It's a business investment, but it has to be pragmatic. We can't always just be chasing the latest shiny bauble. The newest camera comes out and everybody rushes to it. We all do. We're photographers. We love that stuff. But if you want to make money, if you want to be able to pay the bills, then you know we have to be pragmatic about it. And pragmatic doesn't mean being cheap. It means looking for good quality, but being practical about it so that we aren't buying features that we may use someday or we may really like and want to use as we would hobbyist or other genres of photography. Now, if those are things that interest you and you would double use and dual use your camera gear for your business for doing that type of stuff, then you might want to consider that as well. So I'm going to touch on that first, covering all those aspects of things to consider as well as some timeline things that you might expect later down the road. Then I'll actually get into the actual camera and gear recommendations that I made. So I really want to preface this though with all these aspects to look at first. Probably one of the most important things that I'm going to do in this recommendation, it's going to be based off of full frame cameras because they're just nowadays not that much more than a crop sensor camera. If you have a crop sensor camera, that's fine. And one thing too is if you have a camera over the last couple years you're using for real estate photography, if you really don't need to upgrade right now, then you might just want to hold off. We are still suffering from supply chain issues, which is causing some delays and also then price increases in some gear. But if you really do need to go for gear this year and you're looking then for a new camera, backup body, something like that, new lenses, want to upgrade, do something different, then full frame is going to be the recommendation throughout here with the different models that I show. I'm going to shoot for about 24 megapixels. And that's a sweet spot. That gives us plenty enough size so we can crop down images if we need to, and also gives us good high print quality if somebody needs to print something fairly large. Now, there are some things that we don't need to have. We do want to have, if possible, two card slots. Any pro work, you'd want to have a couple card slots to be able to back up, but it's not a necessity. Very rarely have I ever had a failure on an SD card, especially nowadays. They make such good quality ones. And by the way, I'll have some recommendations to things like that for the SD cards, for the cameras, all that in the description for this video. But you can get by even with one card slot if you need to on your cameras. But some of the things you don't need, for instance, are eye focus. Now, some of these mirrorless cameras out today do amazing jobs with autofocus. For instance, here's a picture Dan took here a couple weeks ago. And he wouldn't have been able to do this and catch that owl so sharp if it wasn't for having eye focus. Now, he shot that with a Sony Alpha 1, and Dan does a lot of landscape and nature photography, and he does an amazing work, my brother Dan, but it's not for real estate photography. For business, we're doing real estate photography. I go through bodies every year because of the high shutter count of all the work that I do. For Dan, using the Sony Alpha 1, he does a lot more waiting and planning for his work, for his art, for his landscape work, all that type of stuff. So that's a different animal altogether. So we don't necessarily need to have, eye detection. We don't have to have the high burst counts because we're on a tripod and we're firing off one shot, two shot. We're not doing sports photography here or weddings. it's real estate photography. Also, once again, I'm not gonna be covering video here. If you're trying to get a camera that it's like, this is the greatest thing, and most bloggers and vloggers, they'll tell you that because they'll say, look at what you can do with 8K video and 120 frames per second, that's great. And if you wanna do video at that high of a quality, that's another video that I would make for this channel to just talk about those video recommendations. And you know I also talk about that in my book on videography and other prior videos as well. Another point that I really want to drive home is that when you're looking for cameras, remember that every photo that you looked at in the past was taken with what is now an outdated camera. Those are things of the past. So every camera that comes out every year doesn't mean that you need to get it because you can't take good pictures with older cameras. You know, there was a history of bringing digital into cameras, which changed the world a lot. So there's a whole timeline on that, but we have to remember that any camera that you probably bought in the last couple years probably outdoes most cameras that were built in about the last 20 to 30 years. In fact, technology has just progressed so well across all the camera manufacturers in the last few years that brands hardly even matter. Quality is going to be about the same. There's other things when it comes to brands, like what lenses may be available, what support may be available, but those are becoming to be smaller issues anyways. But we have to remember that when we take a look back over the last 20, 30 years, that it wasn't until just recently that the cameras that we're using today, these digital cameras, even came to be. In fact, it was back in 1999, so about 23 years ago, when Nikon first started making just the DX camera, that format camera, and FX followed quite a few years later. Full-frame cameras really didn't come into being in the digital realm till about 2007. Mirrorless started to come out in about 2018. So we're talking only about 11-year difference between digital full-frame and mirrorless cameras. And we can think, well, that's just 11 years. That may seem like a long time, but it starts to squash this idea that, well, you know, you have to get married to a certain camera ecosystem because of the lenses and everything. And yes, that is important to some degree, but there's always these transition periods, and there is then always something that's going to be waiting down the road for another big switch in technology. So what you're using today and what you decide to buy today, if you're going to be in business for 10 years, more than likely something else will come along in 10 years, but it doesn't mean that the technology that you're using now is going to completely go away. We can't compare this to the film days. We have to remember that everything we're doing now since 1999 has been digital. It's just that some things have changed since 1999. In fact, that change to full frame in about 2007, the change to mirrorless in 2018. So we can see that the digital realm will still be around for still quite a while. It's just that these camera manufacturers will constantly progress every year to make something new. So before getting into the actual cameras themselves, I just want to point something else out, is that when we think about the future and the cameras you're going to be buying, it's good to concentrate on what's out there now and what you think might have staying power, but it won't be there in about 10 years. I guarantee it won't be. Camera manufacturers right now have to play catch up against cell phone quality, which has become excellent over the last few years. So what's going to be probably the next big switch? Well, remember, we had a big switch from film to digital. That's one. That was a major switch. That was an epic switch. But we have those big switches that went from digital DX, the crop sensor format, to digital full frame, and now to digital mirrorless, which is still full frame. So the next big one, which is becoming affordable, now that we're starting to get bloat into the full frame mirrorless realm, it's probably going to be medium format. And you might be going, ah, Nathan, you're full of it. You don't know what you're talking about. Let's take a look at something real quick. Dan's favorite camera right now, and this is an incredible camera, and people are flocking to it like crazy. It's the Sony Alpha 1. This is an amazing full-frame camera, 50 megapixels, but the price is $6,500. So immediately, we're starting to get into a different realm of camera when we consider something that might be just a little bit less expensive. For instance, if we get into the Fujifilm realm, we can get a 51 megapixel medium format camera, the Fujifilm GFX50R. You can buy that for $3,000. Now, that is on sale. Normally, that's about $4,500, but that still is a really good price for a for a medium format camera when we compare that to that more expensive Alpha 1 by Sony. And there's other camera manufacturers that are making similar products as well. For instance, you can get a Pentax 645Z for about $5,000 on sale. It's normally about $7,600. So there, you can, at this point, when we're starting to get into these real big cameras that do just amazing things, but they're still full frame, medium format could come along. Right now, there's the argument that yes, they are slower. These medium format cameras are slower than full frame cameras, but that's just because of who the work has been addressed toward. And everything in a medium format camera would fit what we need to do for still photography for real estate. There's not that much more that has to change. Remember, we don't need to be shooting sports fast. We don't need a lot of those other features. So everything on a medium format camera fits what we would need for real estate photography, but it's overkill. At 51 megapixels medium format, we aren't going to be producing that size of work. So full frame cameras are more than sufficient for now. But when you look at the shiny new baubles that will be coming down the road, I guarantee you in about 10 years, you're probably going to see more medium format and you're going to start seeing people flocking toward this medium format push or whatever that next big switch is. And maybe I'm wrong that medium format would be the next big switch, but there will be a next big switch in about 10 years. It always happens. We also know that gear prices drop every year. Whatever comes out this year is going to drop in price next year. So cameras that you would buy a few years ago, they're less expensive now because they need to get rid of the stock of those cameras that they now need to replace. They want to start pushing their newer models, whatever that is, from all the camera manufacturers. So this brings up the idea that you can also start searching through the used and refurbished market. And there are some good recommendations for that. I'm going to show some of those in my recommendations here coming up. But the two big ones are KEH.com, MPB.com. They come with warranties on their gear. They tell you the condition of the gear. So it's something to really consider. And once again, you don't need to buy the latest thing that's out there. You can buy not even a mirrorless. You can buy still good DSLRs with good lenses, because there's other thing we have to consider. When you're looking at lenses and you say, well, I need to get a Z series camera, or I need to get an R series Canon, or whatever, I'm going to just go with Sony because they're mirrorless cameras, because I need to get married to a certain set of lenses for this ecosystem. One, there's always adapters you can use for your other cameras. But the other thing too is, if you're not really waiting for the next big switch, there will be something else. Lenses don't last forever. Yes, they do tend to last longer than bodies. So I go through bodies every year and my lenses last a lot longer. But I've gone through lenses because the motors inside of them, you do autofocus enough on a regular basis, day in, day out, they'll start searching a little longer than they need to be. And yeah, I could send them in for maintenance. The fact is, they aren't endless. Now, if you have primes, sure, they probably will last a lot longer. But eventually, too, those lenses won't be able to mount. Some of the really, really old Nikon lenses won't work when they're attached to, for instance, the FTZ adapter, which is the adapter you would use for older Nikon lenses onto mirrorless cameras that they're coming out, the Z series. So all those things do change over time. It's not that lenses last forever, it's that lenses tend to last longer than bodies. So those are just the things to consider. Now I want to dive into the nitty-gritty of the actual recommendations based off of everything I just talked about. So prefacing that, let's dive into this, and here are my recommendations for real estate for 2022. So let's start off with the newer mirrorless cameras. If you're looking to get into mirrorless, I'm going to talk about DSLRs here after that. And I'm going to cover three brands: Nikon, Canon, and Sony. I'm sorry for not covering Olympus and Fuji here, but these are the big three right now. So these are the recommendations I have for support, what you can get for lenses, all that type of stuff. Anyways, the one that may be a surprise to you, the Nikon Z5. It's not advertised that much because it doesn't have all the bells and whistles. It's a very simple camera. It does have two SD card slots. It's 24 megapixels, and the price, about $1,300, even just on sale. I mean, if it wasn't on sale, it'd be about $1,400. So that's a great alternative for that. When it comes to the lens, well, we're going to be very limited for that. They have a 14-30 f/4 lens, which is really well rated. I know a lot of photographers that use this and love this lens. is about $1,300. So there's really not yet there's been a lag for Sigma and Tamron, Tokina to come up with Z mount lenses. Same thing when we get to Canon, we talk about the R series. So Sony's been around a lot longer within the mirrorless game. So there's a lot more lenses there that are coming from third parties. But for right now, this is a very high, well-ranked lens. The other option is, of course, you can use the FTZ adapter. So you can use F mount lenses that are less expensive. For instance, you can use the FTZ adapter and use the Tokina 16-28, which I'll show also here in a little bit in the DSLR recommendation. So this is about your limited option here. So when you're taking a look at getting the camera for about $1,300, lens for about $1,300, you're in for about $2,600 for a camera and lens. If you want to go the cheapest mirrorless route using Nikon. Once again, it's not necessarily, I wouldn't call it cheap. It's just the least expensive route to go on Nikon. So now let's talk about Canon. So Canon has the RP model. Now, this is also not a well-advertised model because a lot of people are going for the R6 because of all the bells and whistles that are there. But the RP is a great camera. It's 26 megapixels, and it does do 4K video, a few things. But once again, we're looking for stills here, and can it do a really good job? Full frame, you can see here, 26 megapixels, mirrorless, it's about $1,000. So that's not bad. Now, the one thing here is that it does only have one card slot. If you do want to get into using two card slots, then you're going to have to look at the R6, which is about $2,500. So the RP is a good recommendation that will get you everything you need if you want to go the mirrorless route with Canon. When it comes to lenses, that's when things also get tricky because there really aren't that many lenses available yet for the Canon R series. They do have, Canon has this RF 14-35mm f4 lens, $1,700. That's even more expensive than if you were to go the Nikon route. Now, over time, there will be more lenses come out by third-party manufacturers, I'm sure, and you could use then their adapter. They've got that EF-EOS R adapter that you can use on there to use then older Canon lenses. So that would be one way to go. Talking about Sony, everybody goes to the Sony A7 III, but the A7 II is still a really good contender. The A7 II is 24 megapixels and comes in at about $1,400. This is brand new. There's also the A7C, but that's about $1,800. Now, either the A7C or this A7 II is only going to get you one card slot, but these take fantastic photos, really good quality. If you want to get into the two slots, you would have to go with the A7 III, which is $2,000. So here, about $1,400 for the A7 II, you're looking at spending another $600 to get that other card slot. Lenses are, there's a lot more variety of lenses if you do go the Sony route. So while Sony has their own 12-24 f/4 lens at about $1,800, Sigma makes this 14-24 f/2.8 for about $1,300. So this is a very high-ranked lens. A lot of people I know do use this on their Sonys, so that is definitely a good option to use. So you figure buying about this for $1,300, buying the A7 II for about $1,400, then you're in for about $2,700. Once again, this is still more expensive than going the Nikon route with using the Z5 and their own lens, their 14-30 f/4, definitely could be a way to go. Talking about DSLRs, they are not dead. I don't care what anybody says. These are still being sold. In fact, Nikon still sells brand new DSLRs on their website. They even came out with a brand new DSLR recently, the D780. But this D750 is still a great camera to use. I've still got two of these bodies. They are fantastic cameras for doing real estate photography. Now, new, they are going to cost you probably about $1,800, but you can buy really good used ones on either KEH or MPB.com. And you can see here on KEH, they run about $1,100 or so for something that's in excellent condition. And once again, these would come with a warranty. So something to consider. And the lenses too are a lot cheaper. For instance, we can take a look at getting the Tokina lens. And you know, this is one that I've recommended for a long time. And I use this on my Nikon cameras, and it's also on a Canon mount. And it's the Tokina 16-28 f/2.8. This thing is an amazing amazing lens. Look at my portfolio. Every interior shot that you see was probably taken with this lens. It's $600 brand new. When you pair this $600 lens with a $1,000 used D750, you're only in for $1,600. That's $700 less than going the mirrorless route with even the least expensive Nikon mirrorless camera that's available right now. Canon also offers a great option too when it comes to the DSLR. Canon's 6D Mark II is still a really good option for doing real estate photography. Now, it's not the best ranked camera in their line, but it is really a good workhorse. As you can see, used, this happens to be off mpb.com, it's right under $1,000 for excellent condition. So that's something to really consider there. It's a 26 megapixel camera, does a really good job, and you can even buy them new for about $1,400. And once again, this camera can also be paired with the Tokina 16 to 28 lens, so that when you're taking a look at, once again, 1000 used for the 6D Mark II, and you pop this Tokina Opera on there, brand new $600, 16 to 28 f2.8 lens, great lens, you're looking at about all in at about $1,600. So no matter how you go, whether it's going to be mirrorless, whether it's going to be DSLR, these would be my recommendations here in 2022, once again, for real estate photography stills. Well, I hope this video was useful for you and that you can use some of this in your photography as well. If you did like this video and you want to see more, you can subscribe to my YouTube channel. It won't cost you anything. And as soon as one of these videos is posted, you'll be the first to know. Thanks so much for watching. Until next time, take care, be safe, and get out there and shoot something.